We're members of the National Party, and we're here today in County Clare, where two small villages, Listoun Verna and Ballyvaughan, have become the latest front in the Irish political establishment's war on rural Ireland and the Irish people. These two small villages probably don't mean a lot to box-ticking bureaucrats and government, but to the people who live here, the local communities, they are their lives, they are their communities, they are their past, present and future. And the Irish government has acted with alarming levels of contempt towards the Irish nation.
Decades of mismanagement, bordering on criminal negligence by successive Fianna Fáil and Fine Gael governments, have caused the worst housing crisis here since the land war. The scandal-riddled HSE is in shambles, with waiting lists exceeding 1 million. While Irish children are suffering the brunt of that, Ukrainian soldiers are getting airlifted to Dublin for treatment. The cost of living in Ireland is so prohibitively expensive that the prospect of owning a home and having a family here in Ireland is so out of reach for the ordinary man and woman that our birth rate has plummeted to below replacement levels in less than a decade. This is the true Ireland of 2022, which gets hidden behind our inflated GDP figures.
Listoun Verna, where we are today, is a world-famous tourist destination. It's a spa town with a rich heritage of music and matchmaking festivals celebrated in song and story. It's a charming little village of less than 1,000 inhabitants. Upwards of 800 asylum seekers, so-called asylum seekers, are being housed in local hotels. It's abundantly clear that those in power care so little for what the Irish people think that they believe that it is their right to bring literally hundreds of men with no background checks whatsoever, no background checks absolutely whatsoever, from all over the world and dump them into your community without even giving the locals a heads up, not to mind asking for their permission.
This government will draft plans to house thousands of newcomers within 18 weeks, but we are expected to believe that they're powerless when it comes to housing the Irish people or reducing the financial burden on us as we face a winter of potential energy blackouts. For the Irish home, of course, but never for the data centres. Ireland's best export continues to be its youth, as over two-thirds of the young population want to emigrate, if they can even afford to. There's not a single Irish household in the country that hasn't been hurt by these inexcusable failures. And on top of this, the government add accelerant to this dumpster fire by bending over backwards to support non-Irish nationals ahead of our own. The Irish Examiner reported back in April that Irish support for Ukrainians could cost €3 billion in 2023. The exceptionally shady and corrupt NGO sector in Ireland, which advocates for every group except the Irish, is funded to the tune of €6 billion per annum. We have over 30,000 NGOs and not-for-profits in this country. That's almost as many NGOs as we have square miles. Another issue is the framing of the problem. The framing is always a de facto approval of thousands of migrants arriving into our ancient homeland, year in, year out, vetted or not, legally or not. All the worries of social cohesion, our own cultural identity, sense of community, and control of our own country are forced to take a backseat behind this cowardly attitude espoused by some councillors and media types. We would love to accept as many strangers as possible, if only we had more resources, they say. Some will even point to the uneven distribution of DP centres and areas receiving these migrants, noticing that the well-to-do areas such as Dalkey or Killiney will never get a busload of strangers foisted upon them overnight. And while that's true, I won't engage in that framing, because they shouldn't be sent there, or anywhere else in Ireland, without the express permission of the Irish people. We were never asked, and this government will never ask, because they know that the Irish people would answer them with a firm no.
An open letter to Roderick O'Gorman, the Minister for Integration, by Ballyvaughan Community Development Group, was published online. Contained within it were 8 very reasonable points of concern regarding the sudden influx of people into their community. Ballyvaughan went from a village of 300 population to 700 rising. The points made in the letter were: number one, The Ballyvaughan National School is struggling to cope and more funding is desperately needed. Number two, the Ballyvaughan Medical Centre is full to capacity with the wait for appointment times getting longer and the patient lists getting longer. Number three, the local post office will struggle to cope with the proposed increases in numbers requiring over-the-counter services, even with increased staffing. Number four, the limited volunteer force who have assisted with huge amount of personal time and expense are just coming to terms with the current numbers. Number five, the transport services have only a certain capacity from our rural location. Number six, the onset of winter will require huge input from agencies and already stretched volunteers to organise activities to combat the possible frustration and boredom of displaced persons. Number seven, the small businesses that rely on the tourism that Ballyvaughan attracts throughout the year will suffer losses with the removal of tourist beds from the system. Number eight, the Burden was recently named the best place to holiday in Ireland in 2022. How can Ballyvaughan continue to function successfully as a holiday destination if there is no accommodation available? The group called for an immediate halt to sending more Ukrainians into their village. In rural Ireland, where services are already strained, the government doubled the demand virtually overnight without bothering to consult with any Irish people on the issue. All of the objections raised by the community group here are entirely fair and reasonable, and not even the most rabid of open border advocates could find fault in a town not wanting to be overwhelmed as it is bursting at the seams. These aren't problems that need to be fixed for the sake of Ukrainians or any other group of foreign nationals. These problems need to be fixed for local Irish people, and we don't need any further explanations.
The 1916 proclamation declared the right of the Irish people to the ownership of Ireland and to the unfettered control of Irish destinies to be sovereign and indefeasible. No part of that includes being browbeaten into surrendering our homeland so that our TDs can get cushy numbers working in the UN or the EU when they finish lining their pockets here. The Irish people need to wake up fast. Start remembering who we are as a people. We're one nation, together connected by our roots. We need to stop allowing these traitors to walk all over us and give away our homeland for pittance. Ireland belongs to the Irish. It's not theirs to give away. It was a gift from our ancestors to us, and it's our duty to pass it on to the next generation of Irish people. The National Party will always remain committed to putting the Irish people first in Ireland. We don't care what our detractors have to say about it. We'll support the local communities in every village up and down this country to resist this new plantation. We won't cower in the face of name-calling or government overreach. The National Party represents the Irish people's interests, past, present, and future. We're growing stronger every day. Join us, defend your home, your people, and your future. Ar Yeshe Rath.